Rachel Holt for NESN.com, joined by Adam Rank of NFL Media for Week 15 Fantasy Football News. Adam, thanks for joining us.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. It's a little bittersweet, though.
Not only is our
season coming to an end, but usually when we talk, it means I'm going to go home and then have tacos that evening. And now I've got to wait an extra 24 hours for that to happen. So that's where you can kind of see my moral confliction.
Right. We moved it up to Wednesday, and it is not Taco Thursday anymore. What is Wednesdays, though? Wacky Wednesday? You could do something good today.
Yes, it's Wacky Wednesday. We go crazy. Listen, though, the one upshot is now I have two great days, because instead of, like, having two amazing things in one day, like podcasting with you and tacos, I get to disperse it out a little bit and spread the wealth.
You stop that. I have an unpopular opinion that Wednesdays are actually worse than Mondays. So if anything, you are helping me get through this week, and hopefully you are helping the listeners.
Wait, we're not going to let that go without comment. Why is Wednesday worse than Monday? I'm all ears on this. I'm not judging. I just want to hear your argument.
I have a great job and I love my job, but I just feel like you've been put through the ringer on Wednesdays. You're tired of getting ready. You've done it a couple days in a row here. You're ready for the weekend. It's on the horizon. You just have to get through this hurdle. I don't know. I don't think I'm alone in thinking that Wednesday is not the best day of the week.
You know, it's very interesting because you rarely, or I hope nobody wakes up on Monday. And this is the proverbial Monday. So if you're like, hey, my schedule, I'm off Monday, Tuesday, like, shut up. Like, that's not the point. We're talking about your work, your third work day of the week. I do think, though, because you don't wake up on Monday and be like, oh, my God, is it the weekend yet? Because if you do, then you have a sad existence, and I don't think anything's going to help you out, and every day is going to be terrible. But Wednesday, you're close enough to be like, oh, why can't it be the weekend? Like, even today, the alarm went off. And I was like, why is the alarm going off? Like, plus we had our holiday party last night.
This Wednesday is a particularly interesting one for you, I'm sure.
This is the best time for me to hear this argument, because I think I'm gonna swing to it. I mean, you make a pretty compelling case, but you've got to understand that for me, for the last 14 weeks, Wednesday has been like, well, tomorrow taco night, and I'm doing the NESN podcast with Rachel. So there was a lot to look forward to. So it's tough, but I do see your point. I think that's a salient point. I don't think that's an unpopular opinion. I like it.
Thank you. Well, I reciprocate the feeling that we are excited to talk to you today. It's week 15 of the fantasy football season. If you're listening to this, you're either in the semifinals or the finals. So congratulations. But Adam, there was terrible stuff that happened last week. Our quarterbacks, they were a disaster. They are so bad. We had Drew Brees with zero touchdowns, Ben Roethlisberger, worst fantasy point total since 2008, Russell Wilson, 5 interceptions, a career high, Derek Carr, who many are saying is the MVP favorite, only completing 41% of his passes, 117 passing yards. It was a disaster. We did not get any help from a lot of the top guys. What was up with that?
It was really bad, and one of the things that we do on Fantasy and Friends on Fridays is we have a dumpster dive, and it's usually taking a pretty deep look at some players that, if you're not a savvy fantasy player, if you're a casual enthusiast, who we're here for, you know, we're trying to help everybody out, then perhaps these guys can come out and be of some value for you. And one of the guys we had was Robbie Anderson, who had 9.9 fantasy points. So that turned out pretty well. And then I also said, like, Jared Goff is probably a great start. You know, like, the Falcons ranked dead last against the pass. So if you need to stream a quarterback, he's a good option. And the only thing that saved that prediction from, like, not falling off the table is the aforementioned quarterbacks who actually finished worse than him. I'm like, yeah, if you started Goff and his 9 points over Drew Brees, that actually worked out for you.
Well, Tom Brady was one of the guys holding it down for us in week 14. I know you're on board the Tom Brady train, even though you're a Bears guy, even though you're living in L.A., on Monday night, he threw for 406 yards and 3 touchdowns. He helped his team beat the Ravens. However, now Brady goes up against the Denver Broncos. They've only let 2 quarterbacks reach 20 fantasy points all season long. So does Brady maybe have a hard time this week?
Two of the last five quarterbacks have scored. Drew Brees is one of those 20-point ones. Alex Smith scored 15, and that's a fair number. You're like, okay, you're going up against the Broncos. You can't be expecting a lot out of Alex Smith if you were starting him that week. So if you got 15 in a standard NFL.com league where 4 points are rewarded for touchdowns, you're like, okay, that's pretty good. Like, I can deal with that. And I look at this matchup. And last week, even looking up against the Ravens, you're like, oh, the history against the Ravens wasn't very good. What was it, 11 touchdowns in 8 games or something like that? It just wasn't very compelling, and you just figured it was going to be a low-scoring game, didn't see a lot of offense. But then you're like, oh, yeah, Tom Brady's the GOAT. Like, what am I thinking? Like, that, the whole thing, and I know everybody likes to rave about these other quarterbacks, and I know Aaron Rodgers had, like, a nice throw or whatever. He threw the ball, like, his nice touchdown came to Davante Adams, who he's practiced with for 3 years, so I hope you guys are on the same page when you guys are doing that. But Tom Brady had to sit there with Chris Hogan, who was a free agent who came in from Buffalo this season, and he had to trust that Hogan was seeing the exact same thing that he was and be like, well, I hope he's going to be at this point because I'm putting the ball out there, and I hope Chris Hogan is running past that fool Eric Weddle. And that's exactly what happened. And it's such an underrated thing. It seems like such an easy throw that when you're like, yeah, that guy was wide open. But it's like, no, both guys have to recognize the same thing. And Chris Hogan has to trust that Tom Brady's seeing what he's seeing. And it's hard to do when you've only played with somebody for 15 weeks. So to have that kind of trust and be able to do that, it was pretty, pretty amazing. And so when they go up against the Broncos this week, I don't think that he's going to repeat his 400-yard passing performance. But 264 – 2 touchdowns, I think that's doable, and that's a pretty good fantasy day. And against the Broncos in the playoffs, when I'm sure you have other studs on your teams, I think I would take that.
Okay, so as far as Brady's weapons, you mentioned that 79-yard touchdown to Chris Hogan. LeGarrette Blount had a touchdown against the Ravens. Martellus Bennett, Malcolm Mitchell. Malcolm Mitchell, guy, by the way, who you talked about last week and you said he should pick up. He put up some good points. So they're all getting in the mix. Does the matchup with the Broncos hinder any of these guys? Are you cautious about starting any of Brady's weapons in this game?
I'm really concerned about the wide receivers, and not like I don't think that they can match up and be productive against them. It's like, who is it going to be? Like, who is the guy that they're going to identify? Like, okay, we can go to Malcolm Mitchell a ton, or we can go to Chris Hogan or Julian Edelman or any of those guys. You just don't know. And while I think that Tom Brady can throw 2 touchdowns, one of them is probably going to go to James White. One of them is going to go to a receiver of your choice, and it's really hard to count on that. So I would look at your roster. You probably have some safer options. Outside of Julian Edelman, I wouldn't probably play Hogan or Mitchell just because it's too volatile, and hopefully you have somebody safer to play. But I do feel real comfortable playing LeGarrette Blount. I think they're going to be able to run on this team. That's been their big Achilles heel this season. And they really – I mean, that's the great thing about Tom Brady is that they really can't afford to drop an extra person into the box to try to stop him, because if you do that, then Brady's going to kill you. And it's one of those things that – how do the Broncos want to get dissected? Because it's going to happen. They're going to beat them. They're going to beat them somewhat convincingly, even though they lost to them last year in the AFC. That was a fluke. Like, don't even count that game. And really, it comes down to a fumbled punt in Denver during the regular season. I don't know. I don't have to go over this with Patriots fans. I see them nodding along, so we don't have to belabor this point. But start LeGarrette Blount.
While we're on the topic of Tom Brady and the Patriots and all the good players there, I want your opinion. This has nothing to do with fantasy football. I'm just curious about your insight. We care greatly about this quarterback here at the New England Sports Network. And as we're looking at a potential MVP of the season, we have guys like Derek Carr, Matthew Stafford, Ezekiel Elliott, Matt Ryan, all in the mix for MVP votes. Then we have Tom Brady, who seems like a clear favorite, except for the fact that he missed 4 games of the season, which is a pretty good chunk. So in your opinion, is he maybe able to win the MVP award despite missing part of the season?
You know what's funny is after the game on Monday night, I had kind of tweeted out like, hey guys, real talk, it's time to put Tom Brady in the MVP conversation. And I was doing it as a joke because I just assumed that everybody was lockstep or whatever. Well, I thought everybody was simpatico with me in thinking that Brady is the MVP and anything else is ridiculous. But now everybody throws out other names like Matt Ryan or Derek Carr, who lost last week in Kansas City. And I'm like, whoa, is this really a thing? Are we really going to ignore what Tom Brady's doing because of that bogus suspension? Like, who is the most valuable player? It's Brady. When going back to that Chris Hogan touchdown, Jimmy Garoppolo might not make that play because he might not have read it. You know, that's the whole thing. And also Jacoby Brissett probably doesn't make that play either. And when it's really an interesting thing, too, is that the way that game was kind of unraveling, you know, like the special teams blunders, allowing the Ravens to get back into the game, any lesser quarterback could have really folded under the pressure. We saw what happened to Dak Prescott once the Giants answered them with a huge touchdown. He kind of didn't have the moxie to go win that game in New York and pull it out. So I look at Tom Brady, like he does all that stuff. I don't see him having trouble with anybody. And I think this weekend, when he goes to Denver, when he beats those fools, and he puts up a good enough, just beating them is going to be enough. We're gonna stop the nonsense. It's going to be like, okay, Tom Brady is going to be it. I know some people will still argue for Aaron Rodgers because apparently Aaron Rodgers is the heir apparent to Peyton Manning, is the guy who can do no wrong, and there's not going to be a sports writer who's going to say anything bad about him because his commercials are hilarious and all like that. But this week, when the Bears knock that stupid team off their pedestal, then that nonsense is going to end, and the conversation will be over. We can just celebrate Tom Brady winning another MVP. But let's be realistic. It's not about the MVP award. Like, that's – who cares? It's about a Super Bowl championship. And I'm telling you right now, and this is going to be hard for people in New England to believe, but I'm so sorry to report this. But there are still pockets of Peyton Manning truthers out there who still think that he's in the same category as Tom Brady. But I'll tell you this, if Brady goes out and wins the Super Bowl this year, which I think he will, without Rob Gronkowski, with everything that's been going on, it will be so laughable to even include anybody else in the conversation that you just can't do it. So that's how I feel. I don't know if that was more than what you'd bargained for when you asked the question, but that's where I stand with Tom Brady.
I'm assuming you can feel the Patriots fans nodding along again to that. And if we're going off commercials with funny quarterbacks, Tom Brady recently has shown his acting chops, and they've been getting a few chuckles, I'm not going to lie. It's corny stuff, but he's up there with Aaron Rodgers for the corny, funny commercials now. So maybe that will help his chances.
That's his game. He was brilliant in Ted 2. I thought he was, he's got it. He's got it going on. He just hasn't shown it all yet because he's too busy being an amazing quarterback.
You said it. I was thinking it. On to a different team on the other side of the country. You're in Los Angeles Rams territory over there. I'm sure you've heard this all week long. But, of course, Jeff Fisher was just fired and the team will be without him on a short week when they take on the Seattle Seahawks on the road on Thursday. I just saw that Seattle's a 15-point favorite in this one, so is this a game where you just want to start every Seahawks player you have, or do you think the Rams have a better shot than they do when you just view the game on paper?
Yeah, I'm kind of torn because under Jeff Fisher, the Rams had a lot of success against the Seattle Seahawks. Like, it's crazy. I think it was 4 out of 5 or something like that. Like, they really took it to them. So, and they beat them earlier this year. That was their first win, or not their first win of the season, but they beat them like 9-6 or something. It was an awful game, but whatever, they beat them. So congratulations to them. So they always found a way to beat the Seahawks. And now I wonder what we're going to see out of Seattle this week, because they're coming off a terrible loss at Green Bay. A lot of people are questioning them. I think if this was like a normal week, if the Seahawks were coming off a win in Green Bay, for instance, I think that the Rams could have a chance of surprise. But I really feel with a coach that's brand new, who is a special teams guy. It wasn't like he was an offensive coordinator. It's not like the Rams gave the gig to Mike Singletary, who has head coaching experience. They wanted to give it to the young guy, a guy who's got like kind of a fresh perspective. But when you look up and down that Rams coaching staff, and Jeff Fisher was not necessarily that great. Not that great as an NFL head coach. He's a nice person. Like, everybody seems to really like him, so that's good. So I can say that. But as an NFL head coach, he was clearly outmatched. And now you're bringing in this coaching staff with a lot of question marks and not a lot of substance going on. Like, Chris Wanky I don't know what his deal is, but he's really not an offensive coordinator, and he's the one who's been coaching Jared Goff. So there's a lot of questions that I just look at Seattle and I'm like, gosh, they're going to blow them out. They need an answer really huge. They need to respond after that terrible game in Green Bay. I think Russell Wilson has a great game. Doug Baldwin, all those guys. Yeah, I would try to buy in on all those Seahawks as much as possible. So I would be starting all those guys.
I know at this point we want to start the guys that have been performing for us all year long, but I know I personally have Drew Brees. I have Dez Bryant, who scored minus one fantasy points for me on Sunday. Minus one. He took away from my fantasy points. I have guys like this who I don't know if I can start in week 15. I'm having serious trust issues here. Are there any guys who are usually must-starts that you can see ruining our playoff outlook in week 15?
Yeah, Dez is one that really stands out to me. I remember when I picked Dez, I got him as my wide receiver too, and I was already looking ahead to the playoffs because at the beginning of the season, you saw Tampa Bay in week 15. You're like, all right, yeah, I'm digging this. You know, like, oh, they've got a really nice playoff schedule. It's why I've had Dak as my quarterback for a long time because I just love their playoff schedule. But now it's a little bit tougher, and Tampa Bay poses some serious issues, but I'm still going to start Dez. I have confidence in him, and so I'm going to go with him. And Indianapolis has Minnesota, which is another tough one. And I'm like, gosh, because T.Y. Hilton has got a tough matchup again. And I'm like, do I start him? You know, he's been my flex receiver. So, again, it's a tough issue, but I'm going to roll with him. It's really going to be hard for me to bench some of our studs because we see these guys just come through. And I'm not saying this is a blanket statement like, oh, always start your studs, because you do want to take in matchups. And unless, you know, unless it's really a shutdown team, but when you look at the defenses right now, there's really like not a huge shutdown team that I'm fearing. Like Baltimore has that tough run defense. I mean, obviously LeGarrette Blount scored against them last week, but it's like, okay, well, Ryan Matthews, I won't start him against the Ravens. But you know, if it was another credible running back against him or Denver's a bad example because we just talked about them, but Arizona's a tough defense. Yeah. So starting Drew Brees this week is going to be a huge question mark for me just because he's played so poorly the last couple of weeks, especially one of those games is on the road and you'll hear the people be like, oh, home road splits. And you're like, okay, fine. But he also struggled at home the previous week when he was in the dome and shouldn't have. And he was going up against the Lions, who not necessarily a great defense, but a defense he should have been able to take advantage of. So I look at that matchup against the Cardinals and I'm like, yeah, I'm going to look for another quarterback. I'm going to go start Joe Flacco at home against the Eagles. But other than that, like Drew Brees is the one who stands out to me. But the rest of them, it's like, yeah, I'm going to roll with them. I'm going to give them a shot, unless they've been a big name that's struggled for the entire year, like DeAndre Hopkins. Like at some point, if you're in the playoffs and it's week 15 and DeAndre Hopkins is on your team, odds are you haven't been starting him all along. So it's not going to be a huge issue to leave him on your bench.
Okay, well, speaking of the guys that have been doing well for us, the winner of last week was obviously Le'Veon Bell of the Pittsburgh Steelers. He had the highest individual fantasy score out of anyone since Jamaal Charles in 2013. So given the matchups of week 15 and the big playoff implications of these games, is there any guy you're looking at to have an awesome week 15? And by the way, if you were playing Le'Veon Bell and you still won last week, hats off to you. That's an impressive feat and very rare. But I've heard it a couple times from people this week who said they did just that.
No, it's crazy. Yeah, a number of people have been able to survive. I think if people had Le'Veon Bell but were also stacking him with Ben Roethlisberger, I think that's the photos I've seen of people like taking screenshots and sending them to me on Twitter. Those are the ones I've seen the most. I think I can remember specifically somebody had Roethlisberger, Le'Veon Bell, and Dante Moncrief, and I'm like, oh, that'll do it. Because you got to collect. Because out of the three of them, what do they all average? You know, they added up to 47 points. So, yeah, you know, the scary thing is, though, is I have Le'Veon Bell, and of course, I had a first round bye. But, yeah, so I had a first round bye, and I'm watching him score all his points. I'm like, oh, he's going to do nothing the following week. Like, it's just going to be so awful. Thankfully, I have Antonio Brown. So, if the Steelers are going to score any points against any points against the Bengals and it should be okay. But that's, you're like, oh, can I just carry over those points? Like, that should be a thing. Like, if you have a first round bye, then you should be able to select. Like, you should get the best ball out of the 2 weeks to really give you a home field advantage. But whatever, that's me. Like, listen, if I was the number three seed and I was going up against Le'Veon Bell this week, I would not be saying such things. So that's confirmation bias right there.
Can I just point out that a lot of the things you try to get us to feel bad for you about, oh, I have Dak Prescott, I don't know whether I should start him or not. Oh, I have Le'Veon Bell, I don't know whether he's going to put up the same points. Like, we don't feel bad for you.
You do, though, a little bit. Come on.
A tiny bit, just because you have this way of convincing us. But I just want to point that out, that we don't feel too bad.
Oh, woe is me. I need to stop. I need to sit, Le'Veon. No. But I'm looking, you know, when you're looking at this week, a couple of guys who jump out to me. I think if Bilal Powell is the number one guy going up against Miami, I think that's going to be a great start on Saturday. The Dolphins are actually the third worst defense against the run. So if Powell gets an opportunity to be the lead back, and it's been tough. He's had to battle with the GOAT at running back, Matt Forte. So if he gets the gig all to himself, he should do pretty well. We talked about Joe Flacco. He's got a good. Joe Flacco is so scary because the matchup and everything screams of like, yeah, you should start this guy, but you're like, dude, I don't know. Like Joe Flacco still, like really. Tyrod Taylor is another guy who just looks like a great matchup. He's going up against Cleveland. They've allowed a lot of quarterbacks to have a lot of success, but at the same time, I look at LeSean McCoy and be like, dude, that guy could easily do the Le'Veon Bell, and Tyrod could have a stat line like Ben Roethlisberger did last week. I'm afraid of AJ Green if he comes back. I don't want anything of the Houston Tennessee game. I think Spencer Ware is going to have a monster game against Tennessee. Tennessee did pretty good against the run last week, but the one thing is that Denver offensive line is awful. See, that's the thing. You guys are going to beat them because their offensive line. You talk about the defense. The defense could be the same in Denver, but I think that offensive line is significantly worse. And even though Trevor Siemian is playing much better than Peyton did last year, man, that Denver team's in trouble. Adam Thielen is a nice sleeper for the Vikings. I really like that one. I think the Lions upset the Giants. I don't know what that means, though, fantasy-wise. The Falcons running with Tevin Coleman. Yeah, he's another – that's another one. If you play fantasy on a daily basis – Tevin Coleman's a pretty good value right now. A lot of people are excited about starting Matt Ryan this week, and it looks like a great matchup. But again, I think we're going to end up getting a pretty fair to middling performance out of him. I think like between 15 to 20 points. It's not going to be the 35-point explosion because I think they're going to run on that team so well that it's going to hinder Matt Ryan enough not to be – like he's not – like he's a top 12 quarterback, but I think he's closer to 12 than he is to 1, if that makes any sense. And I think Oakland's going to go down to San Diego and destroy. That's going to be a home game for the Chargers. I don't know if you guys, if you throw on your Sunday, I don't know what game you'll. Oh, no, wait, you guys will be playing at the same time. So at some point during a commercial, flip over to the Chargers Raiders game, and that stadium is going to be all silver and black. They might as well just move to – if the Chargers move to L.A., the Raiders should just move to San Diego because they already own – they own California anyway, so it doesn't matter. But yeah, that'll be a great one for all your Oakland receivers, Amari Cooper, Michael Crabtree, Lattie Murray, all those guys. Go ahead and get them going.
You are a wealth of knowledge, my friend, and this is all
I'm
good
not,
stuff.
But that's nice of you to say.
Well, someone is that's feeding you all the answers to this because I don't know how you come up with that off the top of your head, but good stuff as we head into the playoffs. Unfortunately, our Wacky Wednesday together is coming to an end.
What?
Not to say you can't still do some wacky things today, but our time together is ending. The good news is we can all watch you on Fantasy and Friends on the NFL Network. There's a lot of audience participation on the show. You're having people Skype in, tweet, call all the time. What's on the docket this week?
Well, we got two more shows. Since you're listening to me on Thursday, we're going to be on Wednesday at 6 o'clock your time. We're going to do Trust or Bust. A lot of the same subjects that we've been talking about here. we'll dive into on the show. One of the cool things about it is, like you said, we do have a lot of audience participation through Skype and callers. So sometimes we don't know. I mean, it's what people want to talk about. It's one thing for us to be like, I think everybody wants to know about this, but it's nice to have a handout to the fantasy enthusiast out there who like, no, these are the questions I want to hear about. I'm sure we'll hear a lot about Dak and Ezekiel and those guys, and that's going to be a hot topic. And can Tampa Bay – this Tampa Bay Cowboys game is going to be pretty amazing. I'm really looking forward to it. Again, I thought this was going to be an easy rub for the Cowboys, you know, here in week 15. And they're like, oh, this is going to be great to start all these guys. But Tampa Bay's been playing so well. And if the Buccaneers go out there and win this game, and I think that they can. This team's been playing very well. And if the Buccaneers win this game, then everybody's going to be calling for Tony Romo to start in Week 16. And as a jerk and somebody who likes to see the Cowboys fans suffer, I kind of hope that happens. I want to see the turmoil. So that would be amazing. So we'll be talking about that. A lot of cool stuff, Wednesday and Friday, 6 p.m. Eastern. You can check us out there. DVR it and then watch it at your leisure. But I think you'll enjoy it if you give it a shot.
Okay, I'm into that quarterback controversy continuing all season long, too. Why not? When you have someone like Tom Brady on your team where there's never a question, you like to see everyone else fight it out.
See how the other half lives.
All right. Well, thank you again, Adam. We really appreciate it. Good luck in week 15, everyone.